It's actually been a while since I did an official science news, and it has piled up. I've got like piles and piles of articles. A lot has happened. A lot of very prominent musical artist deaths in the past 3 weeks or so, some of which you've probably heard about, but one of them, Screamin' Scott Simon from Sha Na Na. Maybe you wouldn't really think of Sha Na Na, but he did write Sandy from the musical Grease, and Sha Na Na. It's strange because he joined Sha Na Na like the year after they did Woodstock, and that was the one thing that was kind of surprising to me when I saw the Woodstock movie, was the fact that Sha Na Na was in there. I thought, it's kind of an odd band to have in there, but they have actually a story in this obit, even though he was not in the band at the time. They do explain that Sha Na Na got to play Woodstock because Hendrix was attending one of their early gigs, because they were all students at Columbia, and they did a gig in Manhattan, and Hendrix was in the audience. And this was just like a matter of months before Woodstock was going to happen. And it was actually Jimi Hendrix who recommended to the concert promoters at Woodstock that they should bring on Sha Na Na, and they opened for him when he did his Sunday morning set, that really legendary set where he did the national anthem and stuff. But yeah, so it was Hendrix that got Sha Na Na to play at Woodstock. Yeah, Screamin' Scott Simon. And also, you probably wouldn't have heard Herbie Flowers. But yeah, one of the all-time legendary session musicians on so many records. Yeah, 500 albums, 500 hit-making albums. It's just, yeah, everything from Lou Reed's Transformer to T-Rex to he played on Bang a Gong with Elton John. He played the bass on Space Oddity for David Bowie, Walk on the Wild Side, Lou Reed, worked with everyone, played on virtually every record from the 60s and 70s and 80s that you've ever heard. But yeah, Herbie Flowers, a quiet life behind the scenes, but threaded through rock and roll history. Sail on, Herbie. And of course, talk about Sergio Mendes, legendary Brazil 66. I've got like a dozen Sergio Mendes records. 83, a very good run. I mean, he stayed active. He was still playing out right to the very end. So, I mean, a great career. The most distinctive sound in music, Sergio Mendes. He could put his touch on anything, and yeah. So, huge impact. I don't have to tell you about Sergio Mendes. And of course, probably the biggest, Kris Kristofferson. As far as American composers go, some say Willie Nelson says he was the greatest composer of rock, pop, and country. So, but yeah, it's strange. A lot of people really don't realize Kris Kristofferson. Yeah, he was a country songwriter. Yes, he acted in some movies, but he was also an aviator and an army pilot and helicopter pilot. He was a Golden Glove champion and a football star. He graduated with a degree in English from Oxford University. I mean, things you wouldn't think of necessarily for someone like Kris Kristofferson. But yeah, it's just amazing, the number of hits that he wrote for other people and for himself. I mean, if you want to get the quintessential Kris Kristofferson song, it would be Sunday Morning Coming Down. A lot of people say Me and Bobby McGee would be his number one. Again, another great run out there till the very end. He was still touring just a few years ago, so just Kris Kristofferson. It's like, yeah, it's well, it's Willie Nelson and Bob Dylan, or, you know, and then Paul McCartney, and I don't even think about it. I don't want to think about it. It's just, anyway, an obit that's not about music. Lloyd Kaufman, 97 years old, studied why the moon looks bigger on the horizon. So there he is, right there, rooftop in Manhattan, with Irvin Rock. In 1960. Yeah, so he studied this effect called the moon illusion, which goes back to antiquity. It says here, the moon illusion might be the world's most widely known optical illusion. Some say the earliest record of humanity's awareness of the moon illusion is from a Mesopotamian clay tablet from the 7th century BC bearing cuneiform script that describes the changing sizes of the moon. And it is an illusion. I mean, if you put anything up to the moon for scale, you'll see that the moon doesn't change its size. It's a perceptual issue. And so, but yeah, you know, they basically kind of discovered that as the moon approaches the horizon, the brain changes its sense of perspective. The moon appears to be bigger on the horizon, just because it's either in proximity to things that you could see for scale, like buildings and trees and hills and such. But yeah, it is simply in the brain telling you that the moon's getting bigger when it gets to the close to the horizon. But it says right here, to this day, there is no consensus on what exactly causes the moon illusion. But they do agree that it is human perception. Yeah, so there you go. Moon illusion. I've done a series of videos about the United States and, you know, the drama has gone around and around. The deadline to move the ship came and went. And so, there was a Philadelphia Inquirer ran a double-page spread on the United States, yeah. Yep. The limbo dock. So, yeah. Big picture. You know, people in Philly that have spent years going down and looking at the ship are, you know, dreading the near future. But the basic update on this is that the Florida County approves $10.1 million to buy and move the SS United States. So, yes, so this did go through. Okaloosa County Commissioners voted Tuesday to allocate up to $10.1 million for the purchase, transportation, and related remediation costs. That's the $3 million that they're going to have to pay to the pier owners to have the permission to move it. So that was what was tripping up the deal to begin with. So, but they're going to do that. They're buying the ship for $1 million. They're paying the landlord $3 million, and they're paying the remainder in transportation and prep fees. And they said that it's going to be taken down to Florida and it's going to be cleaned. They said the cleaning process and the preparation process for sinking the ship is going to take maybe upwards of a year. So it'll be above water for a good year down there, and then they're going to sink it. And they said it's due to become the largest intentionally sunk ship to be off the coast of Florida. So, and it will, you know, it'll form a reef habitat for fish and wildlife. So there's no word about when they're going to move the ship. I'd like to know, because I'd like to be there maybe when they do move it. But it might be still at the pier down there across from the IKEA for a little while. Who knows how long. But it will eventually leave Philadelphia forever. So, soon to be over. In other Pennsylvania news, there's a bid for Microsoft to reactivate one of the reactors at Three Mile Island, Central PA. TMI had been shut down since 2019. People famously know it for the near meltdown and damage to one of its reactors in 1979, but they kept running the other reactor up until 2019. They want to use it to power a new data center, but it's not actually like going to be directly, it's not like they're going to build the data center at TMI and just power it. They're actually going to pump that current into the local grid, and then they're going to pull from the grid somewhere else for the data center. It's sort of like they're going to put the energy in Harrisburg and then take it out wherever the data center is going to be. But it's not a done deal, but it's interesting that they may be bringing back a dead reactor just for that. Okay, so time for space news. I talked about the SpaceX spacewalk last time, and this week SpaceX launched the Dragon spacecraft that's going to bring back Wilmore and Williams, and it's a capsule with four seats in it, but they only launched two astronauts. Alexander Gorbunov and Nick Hay went up in the Dragon, and it's going to remain docked to the ISS until February, when it's going to come back with them and Williams and Wilmore in tow, presumably wearing SpaceX suits instead of the Boeing suits that they went up in, because they're going to have to plug in to the console. It's going to have to be SpaceX compatible. I'm not exactly sure how they're going to do that, but I assume that they just took up some suits that they're going to wear. Who knows? Yeah, there's a shot there of the Dragon approaching the ISS. But capsule's up there at the ISS right now. And Williams and Wilmore gave a little interview in September, talking about their change of mission plan. And and Sonny Williams, who I know loves being on the ISS, back when she was doing her original stay on the ISS, I had a digital TV dish and would watch NASA television late at night when they had just the continuous feeds, and watching Sonny do her thing. And she says, in this arc, she says, this is my happy place. I love being up here in space, she said. Yeah. And Wilmore also noted that if his adjustment wasn't instantaneous, it was pretty close. So they're very happy being up on the ISS for a good long stretch. So yeah, no worries. And the ride is arrived, so there you go. And adjunct to that story, of course, Starliner's woes are latest setback for Boeing's spaceflight business. This was basically an article interviewing a bunch of people who basically are looking, you know, have been following Boeing. And Ron Epstein, an aerospace and defense analyst, said it's unclear if or when the company, Boeing, will have another opportunity to bring astronauts to space. So, yeah, people apparently, like, in the aerospace business, people who follow aerospace are really thinking that, you know, Boeing might have a hard time selling Starliner at this point. It's just had so many problems. And, it says, in addition to Starliner, Boeing built the major U.S. portions of the International Space Station and makes government and commercial satellites, and is contributing crucial components to NASA's mission to return astronauts for Artemis, of course. I talked about that last time, too. Artemis is greatly over budget and over time. So it says Starliner alone has suffered at least $1.5 billion, that's with a B, billion in cost overruns. Just for Starliner, that's just for the spacecraft. Billion, including $125 million the first half of this year alone, extra costs that will fall solely on Boeing, not NASA. Very important to note that. And Steve Strict, the manager at the Commercial Crew Program at NASA, says that it would have been a safe, successful landing with the crew on board Starliner. They could have come back on the Starliner, but NASA just deemed it to be a risk that they didn't want to take. I mean, two shuttles lost. They're very wary about putting any astronauts onto any kind of spacecraft that isn't like 100% .00, like ready to go, especially if there are options. and they had options. They knew that they could bring a dragon up. So really, when they looked at the risk assessment, they just thought, we're not even going to try to risk a crew in a spacecraft that's not 100%. A Defense Department auditor found that Boeing's process to address quality control issues was, quote, ineffective, end quote, and that the company had, quote, generally been non-responsive, end quote, in fixing repeated quality problems, the inspector general said in a report. And this is interesting, too. It says here, Boeing also did not have enough trained and experienced employees working on the program at NASA's McLeod Assembly Facility in New Orleans, according to the report, which attributed those deficiencies to difficulty finding skilled workers in that region and failing to pay competitive wages. Very interesting. So, yeah. Oh. Also, the article says that Boeing and Lockheed Martin are also exploring the sale of United Launch Alliance, which is their sideline company, which is one of the major providers of space access in the U.S. Another interesting statistic is, says the size of the global space economy, most of it commercial, has nearly doubled over the past decade to over $570 billion in business last year alone. And the article finishes by saying, Dr. Breyer said, quote, what I'm hearing from my rocket students is that they want to go to work at SpaceX. They want to go to Blue Origin. They want to go with one of these startups. Yes, and who can blame them? They're not in line to go to Boeing, that's for sure. Okay, so in other space dilemmas, the race to salvage a $5 billion NASA mission. I talked about this. This is Europa Clipper. There it is right there on its stand. Talked about this in previous news episodes because turned out a few months ago that the Europa Clipper was supposed to launch this month, and just a number of months ago, like 3-4 months ago, came out a whistleblower reported that the processors that were built into the systems for Europa Clipper apparently were failing rad tests in other products, and so they were wondering whether or not they were going to launch Europa Clipper to Jupiter, or whether it was going to have to be scrubbed and they're going to have to rebuild the avionics. So NASA had spent more than $5 billion on the planetary probe, the Europa Clipper. It's the largest ever built, as big as a basketball court with its solar arrays extended. It's out near Jupiter. It's going to be running with solar power, not nuclear power. It's not going to be plutonium powered. It's going to be solar. So it has a picture here of the massive solar array. Look at that. Being deployed, yeah, the arrays are gonna be 5 panels each. So they talk about the defective components. Mostly these are MOSFETs. Apparently, the article here is saying that the components that they're worried about are individual, like discrete MOSFETs. But they don't know exactly where the ones that would have to be replaced are in the spacecraft. And they worry about the ability of the spacecraft to survive the intense radiation orbiting Jupiter. It's going to be flying as close as 16 miles to the surface of Europa, and it's going to swing past Europa 49 times. Determining the number of MOSFETs in the spacecraft was like figuring out how many roofing nails were used in building a house. Initially, the Tiger team estimated there were almost 900 in the spacecraft. 2 weeks later, it was about 1,500. Replacing them could cost as much as $1 billion. Yeah, money Congress was not going to allocate, and it would take years. So, not only were the MOSFETs vulnerable to radiation, but there isn't just one universal MOSFET in the spacecraft. There are various types and families. Yep, so it says some proposals are that they might power down certain instruments during certain flybys of Europa, sparing transistors from radiation damage. Others are more complex, involving less precise key measurements. So they proposed a solution. What if they took samples of each type of MOSFET that's used in the Europa Clipper, put them in special circuits, and then installed a package in a box that they could bolt to the spacecraft that could send health data back to Earth through the mission? So that's what they're did. They're building this sample box of the various MOSFET types that are in the Europa Clipper, and they're going to be running them out, you know, in a module that's bolted to the spacecraft. They call it the Canary Box, Canary in the Coal Mine. So as these samples begin to fail, they'll know that they're reaching limits on the transistors that are in the spacecraft. So they had this at a meeting on August 27th, and says some attendees of the meeting were dubious about this. They thought that maybe the presenters were succumbing to launch fever, the desire to fly at all costs, and who can blame them? $5 billion and a launch window. So it says that at the end of the meeting that they had, that everybody decided that they're going to go for it. So they're going to have this box, and they're going to try this, annealing of the transistors in flight by running them hot. So they said that Europa Clipper will be on the launch pad October 10th. So they're going to launch it. So fingers crossed, and some makeshift solutions later, Europa Clipper is going to be on the launch pad. See how that goes. Good luck, Europa Clipper. Also, picture here from Bepi Colombo probe that is going around Mercury, right next to a picture of a fish with an eel coming out of its gill. That's like a Z Frank article there about eels that swim their way out of certain predatory fish. So Bepi Colombo did a flyby of Mercury, and it's trying to get captured so that it'll remain in orbit. It's first clear view of Mercury's South Pole region. The latest flyby was perfect, they said. It's a joint mission between the European and Japanese space agencies. Bepi Colombo launched in 2018. It will go into orbit around Mercury in 2026. Yes, it says here the delay was prompted by efforts to overcome problems with the spacecraft's thrusters, so they can't just put the brakes on. They're having to do flybys to gradually be captured. Mercury is difficult to get to because flying toward the sun causes the spacecraft to pick up speed. A series of flybys of Earth, Venus, and Mercury are helping to slow down Bepi Colombo, which will eventually maneuver the mission into an orbit around Mercury. Colombo grazed the planet just 103 miles above its surface. That's considering the size of the orbit. that's pretty good navigating. Yeah. Some close-up images there of the South Pole region, Mercury, and it'll take a couple more years, but Bepi Colombo will settle into an orbit around Mercury. And this, also interesting, finding a black hole that has a cosmic wingspan. Yes, this is an artist representation. Yeah, so astronomers recently announced that they had discovered a black hole spitting energy across 23 million light years, not miles, light years. Two jets shooting in opposite directions compose the biggest lightning bolt ever seen in the sky, about 140 times as long as our own Milky Way galaxy is wide, or 10 times the distance from Earth to the galaxy Andromeda. That is a couple of big jets, yes. Yes, so the eruption is occurring in a galaxy 7.5 billion light years away that existed when the universe was less than half its current age, was, and presumably still is, because it would still be there, even though we're seeing it 7.5 billion years ago. I mean, black hole's not going to go anywhere. But the black hole at the heart of that galaxy making these jets is spewing energy equivalent to the output of more than a trillion stars. Wow. And the discovery raises new questions of how such black holes could affect the evolution and structure of the universe. Definitely so. Astronomers have named the black hole Porphyrion, after a giant in Greek mythology. Porphyrion? Am I pronouncing that correctly? Porphyrion? But yeah, quite a show. Quite a show indeed. Okay. And not to be outdone, cosmic cataclysm will bring a new star to the Philly skies. Well, and yours too. This is a so-called reoccurring nova star, T. Coronae Borealis, which periodically mutates into an Earth-sized hydrogen bomb, will flame out in less than a week. But you'll see a star. It's going to get as bright as the North Star, Polaris, but only temporarily. Precisely when the nova will be visible is unclear. Nailing the timing is a bit more complicated, blah, blah, blah. Could be a week, maybe a month, maybe not till winter, but soon. Star explosion already happened about 3,000 years ago, it said. Astronomers know the explosion has occurred because it happens about once every 80 years. It was last observed in February 1946, and before that, May 1866. And apparently accounts of this repeating nova have gone back to the writings in the Middle Ages and even before then. Why does the nova keep exploding? It says the star's nearest neighbor is a gigantic gaseous nuisance. The nova is a white dwarf, the lesser half of the binary star system. And so the red giant leaks hydrogen, and the white dwarf takes on that hydrogen, and then about every 80 years or so, all that extra hydrogen detonates into a mini nova. And the white dwarf is an Earth-sized core of a dead star that is unimaginably hot, perhaps exceeding 180,000 degrees Fahrenheit, which isn't that hot for a star. I mean, the core of an active star like our sun is in the many millions of degrees. So it says here, about every 80 years, the white dwarf just says, enough accreted mass already, I'm going to blow up. And it does. Okay. So some point in the next few months, it's going to be a little mini nova coming to a sky near you. And the last on the space news, it's sort of quasi-space news, because it's actually like almost like military news, but it's not something I would see on Scott Manley. Satellite images show that a missile exploded in a test in Russia. Apparently a silo for a new intercontinental ballistic missile blew up, leaving quite a crater. So obviously this is something that there will be no news about, because it's going to be completely top secret. It's not like the Russians are going to talk about it. Apparently this is one of the new Sarmat missiles. Probably blew up in the silo while they were fueling it, creating a 200-foot-wide crater at the Sarmat launch site in northwestern Russia. So, presumably it did not have a warhead on it. But nothing to tell, but a crater nonetheless. All right. This is a series of articles about food and heavy metals. There was I talked last year about elevated lead levels in cinnamon that was caused by people who are manufacturing cinnamon abroad, that these companies were adding lead to cinnamon to make it redder and heavier, and then companies in the U.S. were just buying the cinnamon, by the ton, not testing it for heavy metals, putting it into foods, and children got lead poisoning. Well, it turns out that they've gone on to do more Consumer Reports testing, and elevated lead levels in 1/3 of all cinnamon samples tested by Consumer Reports. So, to varying degrees, it's a problem. And there's also, Consumer Reports had done an analysis last year about chocolates, which was an eye-opener for me, because I practically live on chocolate. And it turned out that some of the chocolate that I was eating had like really crazy high levels of lead in it and cadmium. And I had to switch brands, because I was really starting, it was really exacerbating my nerve issues, as it would if you're basically got elevated lead and cadmium levels. It definitely exacerbates existing nerve problems. But so it says here that one dozen of 36 cinnamon products tested by Consumer Group contained Elevated levels of lead, according to a study released on Thursday, this was September, a study by Consumer Reports documented levels that were far lower than the amounts discovered last year, which were, yes, like toxic. But basically, it's showing that this is a supply chain issue with cinnamon, not just cinnamons, but also with other red-colored spices, including curry powder, chili powder, cumin, and five spice powder, many of which had more than one part per million of lead. But they do reiterate that the levels in the cinnamon applesauce that were found last year that the kids ate was like 1,000 times higher than this. So, you know, I guess it's like anything else. One of the really weird realities these days is because there's so little accountability, and because, honestly, really comes down to the fact that, at least in the United States, food manufacturers are not required, they're not required to test their own foods for toxicity, for heavy metals and such, because they push that responsibility down the supply chain, and they basically get pieces of paper from manufacturers in Asia that say that the food that they're importing passes all inspections and is free of lead and cadmium, whatever. That piece of paper is what they use to say, well, look, there's no lead in it because the piece of paper said there's no lead in it. They don't actually go and test. They're not required to do that. So, I mean, really, the way to keep heavy metals and other kinds of contaminants out of the food system is you got to make companies test for it before they put it in the food. But Congress recently passed legislation in the Supreme Court also to reduce the power of the FDA and the EPA tremendously, so agencies in the United States no longer have the power over industry to institute controls like for lead and cadmium, mercury, things like that. So you can thank your congressman for putting the metals back in your food. And, contrary, mercury dental fillings and the new EU ban. So, in the EU, they are getting rid of amalgam fillings once and for all. I've gotten rid of all mine. It took like 20 years for me to slowly get rid of all the amalgam in my mouth. But I did have a lot of it in there. People will say, oh, you know, Fran, it's like... The mercury in amalgam fillings can't hurt you. It's an amalgam. It's in the metal. It's like, well, yeah, that's in a perfect world. You know, maybe the amalgam in a sealed container might be harmless, but in your mouth, where you're constantly eating acidic foods and grinding with your teeth and everything, you're constantly taking off layers of that filling. And, you know, yeah, the mercury comes out of the amalgam. That mercury is, it's in there, but as it wears down, but anyway. Yes, the American Dental Association said that it does not call for an immediate and complete phasing out of amalgam fillings, but is supporting the continued phasing out of the fillings. So yes, of course, the American Dental Association would never go back on that. They've given it the thumbs up for forever. The United Nations Minatama Convention, a global treaty adopted by more than 140 countries, including the United States, that requires countries to phase down the use of dental amalgam. The treaty is named after the Minatama Bay in Japan, where, in the mid-20th century, industrial pollution containing mercury contaminated seafood and sickened thousands of people. Slowly phasing out mercury in the mouths of people. Slowly. But they don't want to give up that amalgam. It's just so easy to do. It just works so well. All right. And last on the food-related contamination, how Cheetos disrupted an underground world. Yes. Right there. Photograph of a bag of Cheetos that was dropped off a trail by a visitor in the big room at the National Park Carlsbad, New Mexico. Yes, so Albuquerque, New Mexico, bag of Cheetos gets dropped and left on the floor. Seems inconsequential, right? Rangers at Carlsbad Caverns National Park in southern New Mexico describe it as a world-changing event for the tiny microbes and insects that call this specialized subterranean environment home. Says the bag could have been there for a day or two, or maybe just hours, but the salty morsels of processed corn made soft by thick humidity triggered the growth of mold on the cavern floor and on the nearby cave formations. The ecosystem of the cave had a huge impact. So the article goes on to talk about how the people who work in the caverns spend time and put great effort into removing contaminants to try to preserve the ecology of the cavern. It says more than 300 million people visit the national parks each year and dump about 70 million tons of trash. That's all of the parks. That's not Carlsbad Cavern. It's all the parks. But it takes lots of work to round up the waste. The Carlsbad Caverns volunteers comb the caverns collecting lint. One five-day effort netted as much as 50 pounds. It's such a dark area, sometimes people don't notice that it's there. They're trying to get out the message of leave no trace. As for the spilled Cheetos, we're told the Associated Press that could have been avoided because the park doesn't allow food beyond the confines of the historic underground lunchroom. But after the bag was discovered in the cave specialists in the park settled on the best way to clean it up. Most of it was scooped up, and then a toothbrush was used to remove the rings of mold and fungi that had spread to nearby cave formations. If you're gonna spelunk, do not take your snacks with you in the national parks. Yeah, this is kind of a downer. You probably wouldn't see it anywhere else, but Science Times had a damage in the desert. So these are, in Chile, in the extremely dry desert, they have these 3,000-year-old geoglyphs, which you can't see underneath of all the ATV tracks, but you can see down here, right down there, that looks like a little sign, an observation area for people to view the geoglyphs, which are on the hill here, which are, well, they're now obliterated by the tracks. And so apparently in Chile, see, here's another one here on a hillside, they've been having these rally races, these desert races of all-terrain vehicles, and they have been, over the last few years, they've been obliterating geoglyphs. And apparently these races were sanctioned by local officials, although because of the uproar from, people who want to preserve the geoglyphs, the Chilean government is now starting to intervene because they had left it up to local officials to sanction these races, and apparently there was no oversight, and they talk about regional officials that approved the rallies, and they didn't really follow up on any of it, and yada yada. Yeah, it's just damage done. It's like there's, and they can't prosecute anyone because the people who did the races, they all believe, they come from all over the world, and they're apparently it's all like an anonymous, or the race people who run the races aren't giving up any of the names, so it's like they can't prosecute anyone. There's no one to blame for it. It's just damage done. But apparently there is some response down in Chile to stop it from continuing, but it's like, what are you gonna do? It's like you're gonna have like less of this, or you're not gonna add to it. It's like Humpty Dumpty, Humpty Dumpty geoglyphs. It's a shame. This is why we can't have nice things. That's why I say it's people. This is why we can't have nice things, people. Find a way to mess it up. So ended on a positive note about a young couple who have the old friend photo booth. They bought a photo booth from a guy who used to have a photo booth business, and they refurbed it and got it working, and it's an actual chemical photo booth. It's not like a little inkjet printed thing. It's a real photo booth with, you know, the real chemistry and everything. Ms. Lazarton and Mr. Milton, both in their 20s, eventually they got in touch with a former photo booth technician in St. Louis who had acquired several photo booths decades ago and had sold all but one, and so they bought that one, and they had some trials and tribulations getting it working, but they installed it in New York. It's a dying art form, Ms. Lazarson said. There's a community of people that want to keep it alive, and we're along for the ride. So, here you go. The old friend photo booth. I'm sure you can Google it if you're in Manhattan. Get your picture taken. There's more. There's a whole pile, but, you know, this has gone on long enough. The last little piece of news, very short, is I don't know if I'm going to do an individual video on this, but I'll tell you right now. YouTube announced just this week that they're going to start allowing 3-minute shorts. So the shorts are actually going to be up to 3 minutes. That takes effect in a couple weeks. It's a big deal because I've been trying to condense info shorts down to under 60 seconds, and it got kind of comical. But I had some that I've been wanting to do, but the scripts are just too long, and I've been whittling down and editing, and I just can't get it anywhere near under like a minute and a half. Well, now we're going to have 3 minutes instead of 60 seconds to do a short. Same format, vertical or square, but anything in that orientation that's going to be under 3 minutes in a few weeks will be considered a short and go on the shorts feed and everything. So I think that's a game changer. And definitely I'm going to be on board to make like condensed infotainment shorts that are going to be longer than a minute, but less than 3 minutes. So stay tuned on that. Okay. Well, that's it. I'm Fran. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all the patrons down on Patreon. Thank you. All my patrons. I'm going to have to do another Patreon push. We have another merch campaign, but I want to thank all the patrons who went in and upped their pledges for the recent shortfall, including my very first trustee level patron. Thank you. You know who you are. Thank you so much. So yes. Patron, that's how we do this stuff. And I'm Fran, I'll be back doing something else here, factory, or over at the drafting table, don't know, real soon. At the bench again.